What are you doing?
Oh, hey, Maria. I'm here getting ready for my stress test.
It's not a stress test for people. It's a stress test for gadgets.
Gadgets? Oh, looks like I got the wrong stress test.
Yeah, you'll like this one a lot better. Follow me.
Okay, you got it.
So we head to the Consumer Reports Gadget Stress Test Lab.
This is where we test gadgets, mobile devices, such as smartphones, smartwatches, tablets, to see if they can stand up to the manufacturer's claims for durability, and also to see if they can handle the typical physical harm that consumers might put them through. We use these picks for it. These are picks that are calibrated to the Mohs scale.
What is the Mohs scale?
The Mohs scale is a scientific standard that is used to evaluate the hardness of minerals. It works on the principle that a harder material will always scratch a softer material.
Oh, I see. So you kind of go through a soft scratch all the way to a very hard scratch.
Correct. So the scale is 1 to 10, 1 being very soft like talc, and 10 being very, very hard like diamond.
So why don't we start the test?
Of course.
All right, we'll start from scratch.
Okay.
Maria starts with a number 7 on the Mohs scale.
And this going back and forth, there's no scratch, it's very smooth.
Does that mean that the watch is scratch resistant?
No, it means that the material of the watch is harder than the material on the pick.
So Maria swaps out the 7 pick for an 8.
It's scratching. Now we know that a number 8 can scratch this watch.
Right.
How does this then help a consumer when it's time to purchase a watch?
Right, well, we're checking the watches comparatively. So another watch that maybe doesn't scratch until 9 or maybe not even scratch at 9 will have a harder surface and will be less susceptible to scratches. We could also do this kind of a test on phones. Same thing, if you don't want scratches on the face of your phone, we could figure out which ones are more susceptible to scratches than others.
Okay, so now that we know this, are there any more tests we gotta do?
Yeah, we have plenty of equipment in here. Let's move on to the next one. So Jack, this is our depth pressure chamber.
What exactly does it do?
We use this for a dunk test. We use it to test devices such as smartphones or smartwatches or action cameras like this for the manufacturer's claim of how deep underwater it can go. In this case, this particular action camera is supposed to be able to go to 33 feet underwater. That's the manufacturer's spec for it.
So even though it's not 33 feet, then how do you simulate that to get an accurate reading?
So 33 feet under the water actually exerts pressure. The water itself will exert pressure on the device.
Okay.
In this case, we're going to simulate that pressure with air pressure.
Oh,
and that's
so
what this tank
both.
Does. Yes.
All right, great.
And I get to play lab assistant.
We have some compressed air here. Would you turn on that valve? Just swing it over.
All right.
Until it reaches the simulated pressure of 33 feet underwater.
Okay, so in a real test, we would leave it in for 30 minutes, but for this demonstration, we could take it out now.
Okay.
All right, so first we have to release the pressure.
All right. We're almost there.
Finally, the moment of truth arrives.
Okay, Jack, you wanna take the lid off? And then we'll take it out. We'll dry
it
off. Look. It's working.
It works.
Looks like it's working. We can see your face in it.
Yeah. Hi.
This is our tumble tester. We use this to test mobile devices such as a smartphone or a tablet to see how it can withstand being dropped.
Okay. Here's a phone.
All right.
Should
let's try it. Yep.
And soon, it's rumbling and tumbling around.
It's gonna rotate. It's not moving particularly fast, but it's enough to have the phone drop from end to end repeatedly.
It looks like it's being completely wrecked in there.
Well, it's dropping about 3 feet, which would be like off a table or out of your pocket, about that type of a height. The theory is that the phone will drop in all different orientations so that you kind of get it everywhere, and if it can come out of this alive after 50 or 100 of these drops, it's going to be pretty resistant to a drop.
It's hard to believe any phone could withstand this kind of punishment. And yet...
All right, let's see the results.
It passed.
It works.
Yep.
Do you feel that more manufacturers are making stronger phones because of a test like this?
So what we do find is that there are many phones that can pass this test. Even after 100 drops, they come out without damage, or there's some that would just take a little bit of damage.
Okay. So we have one more test, Maria.
So Jack, this is our drop tester.
So what is the difference between the drop tester and the tumbler?
So the tumbler will drop the phone in any different randomized orientation. With the drop tester, we can orient the phone to drop on its corner, on its edge that we want, any kind of face that we want.
Well, my phones, every time they drop always like on the corner.
On the corner?
I don't know why, yeah.
All right, let's try that. So we're gonna put it on the corner right here. Here we go.
That was it?
That's it. It landed on concrete.
And there's just a smudge on it?
So I'm looking to see if the phone actually got scratched or smudged. It turns out that was just concrete dust. See, it wipes right off.
Yeah.
So the phone itself is not damaged. The phone itself is still working.
That leaves Maria feeling pretty good about her work here in more ways than one.
As an engineer, I appreciate that we're doing this in a scientific way. And as a consumer, it's important to me because I just dropped my phone a little while ago. So I'd like to know which phone will last longer for me as well.
Thank you so much, Maria. I really learned a lot from these demonstrations.
You're welcome. Jack, don't forget your cell phone.
I don't want to leave this in there.